Hello, I'm Jessica from Saxo, and standing by is the world's biggest mining and commodity company, BHP. David Lamont is the Chief Financial Officer, and he's just handed down spectacular results for the full financial year for BHP. David, thank you so much for joining us.
Great to be with you, Jessica.
So congratulations on your results. Just tell us about some of the key highlights.
Well, certainly to start with, we were really satisfied that it's 3.5 years that we've operated fatality free. I always think that's a great thing to start with because it underpins the operational discipline that we have and how we actually look after the care and well-being for the staff that we actually have at the business. Outside of that, underlying attributable profit was $21.3 billion, up 26%. And that's an outstanding record for us. What it also has enabled us to do is declare a record dividend. So our final dividend will be 175 cents per share US, which will bring the full year payout to some 77%. And on the back of that, we certainly are rewarding shareholders as part of the overall process.
Yeah, an absolutely cracking result and absolutely delighted shareholders across the world as well. If we just pivot to 5 years from now, David, your revenue split majority at the moment is from iron ore, about 27% from copper. You've got your coal and petroleum business as well. But 5 years from now, what do you think BHP or what does BHP want to look like?
Well, certainly what we have said and our strategy is about growing in those future-facing commodities. So that's copper, that's nickel and potash. So in 5 years' time, as we have said, our Jansen project will be coming to the market in 2026. That's a substantial new commodity for us into the portfolio. So that brings a new wedge into that revenue split. I mean, obviously what we have done with the Woodside merger of our petroleum business, the petroleum business steps out. So the potash we see as a really good replacement for the petroleum part of the business. But we want to continue to grow also in copper and nickel. And we see that we have great opportunities in-house to do that. We have a very large nickel sulfide resource, the second largest in the world in Western Australia. And we also have a great endowment of copper, both here in Australia, but also in our South American operations. So what we would like to see in 5 years' time is that both the copper, the nickel and the potash business are delivering into that mix of revenue.
Gotcha. And China has absolutely got a very close tie with BHP, and sales have been steadily increasing for half a decade and make up about almost 70% of the business's revenue. How do you think this might potentially change over time, David? And what would happen if China does start producing their own iron ore?
Well, certainly the growth that you've mentioned, Jessica, is about the growth in iron ore. Now, what I would say to you with potash, as I mentioned earlier, coming into the portfolio, you know, primarily the markets for that won't be China. So that gives us some diversification away from China as the potash comes into the portfolio. Specifically within China itself, China doesn't have any substantial iron ore deposits within the country. Now, certainly what they are looking to do is see whether they can purchase from outside in other places, and they're focused on you know, West Africa as a major area. But for us, what we're looking to do is continue to grow our iron ore business. We're currently at 290 million tonnes. We've announced that we're studying expansion to 330. So, you know, roughly a 10% increase there on iron ore, and we would look to bring that to the market as well as part of the overall equation.
Brilliant. Wonderful. And can you give us away a potential revenue split in the future? You're still the biggest producer and exporter of iron ore in the world, but crystal balling, what will that revenue split look like in the future? And what do you foresee as the iron ore growth for the future?
Yeah, so what we have said is that, as I said, internally, growing the iron ore business from 290 to 330 is an important equation into that. Now, ultimately, the revenue will determine by the price that we see. And what we have said is through to 2030, we see steady demand for the underlying steel production. Under a decarbonised world, the world will still need steel. And we see that about 1.8 times in the next 30 years versus the historical 30 years. And just as a reference point, you know, we see about double the amount of copper over the next 30 years versus the prior 30 years, and about four times the amount of nickel. So all of that will come into the mix as to how that portfolio shifts over time. Ultimately, the steel manufacturing that we see post this decade will start to plateau off. And that's something that we're keenly focused on. What we're also, though, seeing is how do we retain our position as the lowest cost producer? Because being the lowest cost producer puts you in the best place to buffer whatever that underlying demand picture looks like.
And indeed, you've been the lowest cost producer for some time. Just shifting to the green transformation, so the copper, the potash, and perhaps potentially the lithium as well. Can you just pinpoint or highlight some of the key focus areas or embellish for us, if you will, on some of the key focus areas for the green transformation?
Yeah, so certainly for us, it's about focusing on those future-facing commodities, which we do see as being copper, nickel, and potash. What we keep a close watch on other commodities outside of that basket and to see what that looks like. For us at the moment, we don't like the overall market dynamics in relation to lithium as an example, but it's a watching brief. We like the demand side of things. We certainly think the demand will be there. We just don't quite see where the supply side fits our equation. You know, at the end of the day, that's what we are. We're a supplier of these key commodities into the world. And under a decarbonised world, we certainly see strong demand, as I mentioned earlier, for copper, nickel. And also, the world needs to continue to feed itself, and that's where the potash and the fertiliser thing sits. We see those as being the best way to leverage our expertise and also deploy capital into those commodities at this stage. Now, we continue to look at a range of others, you know, whether that's lithium, cobalt or other areas, but at the moment, we don't see them fitting our portfolio.
Wonderful. And David Lamont, absolutely congratulations on a smashing record result. But before we let you go, is there anything else that you wanted to add today?
Well, the only other thing that I'd mention, Jessica, is we are a substantial contributor to global economies. We did call out that our total contribution across the world was some $72 billion. So we understand that we're an important input into the world's economy. We're looking to continue to leverage that and ensure that we deliver to shareholders like we have just done with that record dividend.
Wonderful. David Lamont, thank you so much and have a wonderful day.
Thanks, Jessica. Same to you.